Welcome to the Wish I'd Known Then podcast, where we focus on how authors found success, looking at strategies that have taken them to the top of the bestseller charts, as well as what they've learned from their mistakes. Because being an indie author is more than knowing the latest marketing trend. It's about being innovative and creative and learning from your mistakes.
Welcome to the Wish I'd Known Then podcast. I'm Sara Rosette.
And I'm Jami Albright. And this week on the show, we have
Renee Rose.
Yes, we do. And it is so good. Renee is a erotica, paranormal romance author, and she, but she's also just written a book called Right to Riches, which is a mindset abundance book. And it is so fantastic. I read it or listened to it when we were on our cruise, and just really opened some things up for me that I had never really thought about. And it was really good. It was a great interview.
It was very good. We talked about just blocks, that common blocks that writers have that kind of hold us back, and about mindset, about money blocks, about and negative self-talk, a lot of stuff that's very often we don't realize what we're doing and how it impacts us.
Right. And it's not just for woo-woo people. I mean, Sara's not.
I'm not as woo-woo as Jami.
She's not near as woo-woo as me, and I'm not that woo. I mean, I'm woo-woo, but not as much as other people. But yeah. I mean, I would say that we both got something out of this interview. It was really good. Really good. Because it's just the way you think about things and how we get in our own way sometimes. So
she had a lot of things. I have a lot of notes that I wrote down. It was very, very good.
That was good. Well, we're recording this the day after we recorded the last one. So what have you been doing since yesterday, Sara?
Not much. I've been doing knit-knowing end-of-the-year things. I am taking a class with Becca Syme. I'm doing input because I've never done. She has focus classes. So I'm doing that one. And it's been really good. And it's funny that you know how you'll have certain strengths and you're you can see certain things. Mm-hmm. And I just don't really think about input very much for me. It's my number two.
And strength. I see it with you all the time.
And so now I'm taking the class. I'm like, oh yeah, I do that. Okay. Yeah. So anyway, it's been helpful. And one of the things I learned is inputs need to be organized so they can find all their stuff. And so I think one of my year end things is I'm going to go through my computer and sort things out. I think it'll make me feel better. That's all I've been doing. That and some Christmas shopping. And that is about it. What about you?
Well,
how's the check mix going?
I'm still making checks, mix and fudge. I'm up to my eyeballs in it. but it's been fun. And I'm still here with my grandkids and they're fun. And you can probably hear them screaming in the back. They're playing. They're not upset. They're just loud. Which is what happens when you have four toddlers in a room.
Yes.
So they're super fun. And that's about all that's been going on. I'm done with my shopping. I've got a few stocking stuff things I need to do, but I'm going to order those. That way I don't have to go back out into the wild.
The crowds.
But anyway, this will be aired the week after.
Yeah, so this will probably be the first podcast of 2023 that comes out. So this will be perfect.
Happy New Year.
Yeah, this will be perfect for kind of all of our wanting to do better in the new year.
Anyway, well, let's listen to Renee because she was great and we can get on with the interview.
All right. Here's Renee. All right. Today we have Renee Rose with us. How are you, Renee?
Great. Thank you so much for having me. I'm excited.
We're excited. As soon as I read your book, your most recent nonfiction book, I was like, we got to get Renee on. So I'm glad you're here.
Yeah. So let me read your bio and then we'll get right into the interview. 11-time USA Today bestselling romance author Renee Rose is passionate about helping other authors find and maintain an abundance mindset to catapult their careers and create their best future. Which I love that.
Thank you. And it's 15 time now. Although
awesome.
That may be the end of it, I guess, as far as
I guess.
We know about
USA Today. We don't know. That's so weird. I know.
We can hope for 2023.
I'm glad that wasn't on my bucket list because that'd be kind of disappointing. But
exactly.
Yeah. That's too bad. It is too bad, though. It's too bad. Yeah. Well, tell us how you got into writing, Renee.
Well, I have always been a writer, but I took the detour of, so I got my degree in creative writing, but I was specializing in poetry then. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, knowing that no one was going to hire me to be their poet.
It's a good side hustle, though, right?
Poet laureates. There aren't a lot of job openings for that.
Yeah. So I was working as a technical writer, actually, and then someone handed me a romance novel. And I was like hooked. Mm-hmm. I was like, this is my jam.
Yeah. Yeah. Exactly. Awesome. That's really how I was too. And how long ago was that? I mean, when did you actually publish your first book?
2012.
Okay. Yeah. So that was kind of back during the boom. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, tell us, what is your definition of success?
Well, if you'd asked me a few years ago, I would have had a bunch of definitions for it because I was like measuring myself against, you know, some stick. So it was like, okay, well, I hit USA Today. So am I successful enough now? And then it's like, well, not yet. You know, now I make six figures. Is that successful? And it's like, no, I still wasn't successful. I had to get to seven figures to, you know, I was like trying to prove I was a real author somehow. I had this like, I was looking for outside affirmation that I was worthy. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so now I have done the work and know that, you know, success is if, are you joyful? Are you, you know, enjoying creating, right? Do you love your books? Mm-hmm. Like that to me is success. Like, but it took me a journey to get here.
Yeah. I think we hear this a lot, like it changes over time, you know, it evolves or in your case, it totally kind of flips because you've sort of realized some things about yourself or not sort of, you have, and just about the world in general that is much more healthy, I think.
Exactly. Yes.
Yeah. Well, what do you wish you'd known about writing and craft when you got started?
Well, for craft, I would say like the thing that really changed things for me and made it like much easier to write a book was the Romancing the Beat book by Gwen Hayes.
Yes.
First of all, it made plotting easier because now I understood like the structure, and then it made me understand like why some books had failed because I missed the beats, you know? So it's like when you hit those beats, people are always satisfied. And if you screw with them, it can work, but sometimes it doesn't, you know?
Yeah. I mean, we talk a lot about this on the podcast, but genre expectations, and each genre has their own beats and the only, their own roadmap for how that type of book should get from the beginning to the end. You can go some other ways, but you need to hit those beats. So
yes,
I love that book. I use it all the time as well.
It comes up a lot on the podcast. Awesome. And there's a new book out, Anatomy of Genres by John Truby. I think it's pretty new. It looks at each genre.
Yes. So
I have my copy, but it's super thick and I haven't made it through it yet. So if you write romance, I think Romancing the Beat is like the holy grail, right?
For
that. It's pretty good.
It just clarified things for me. It made it a lot easier. Yeah.
I love in it how she at the end shares a short story where she hits all those beats and you get to see that. And
yes,
because I'm that kind of visual learner. I'm like, oh, okay, now I think I can do this.
Yeah. And like I used to listen to that whole, I forget what it comes from, where there's like the twist point or whatever. And I was, pinch points. What the heck's a pinpoint? I could never figure it out. And then her book just made it so clear. I'm like, got it.
Yeah. That's so good. Yeah.
Yeah. Examples are wonderful. Yeah.
Yes.
Yes.
Well, what about marketing? What do you wish you'd known about marketing?
I think my takeaway from marketing is to be fearless. Mm-hmm. And one of those things is, again, that stopping, like if you think you're not worthy, you're not marketing your book. Like if you have the I'm worthy when you're marketing your book, you're going to be fearless, right? You're not going to think you're going to fail. And yeah. so like, if you're feeling like your book is, and that doesn't mean like to over, like it's, you got to know when to spend and not to spend too, like not to just like dump, right. like I've definitely been in the position of like dumping money into a book that was floundering because my ego couldn't take it floundering, and it didn't like dumping more mm-hmm. money didn't help the situation.
Right. Right. Exactly.
So like you got to exactly. know when to pull back and when to push. But, mm-hmm. But I think that if you are fearless, you know, fear like can really stop us from promoting ourselves, that mm-hmm. it can stop you from like reaching out to another author for a newsletter swap. It can stop you mm-hmm. from making a post, making your TikToks, making a post on Facebook. Mm-hmm. Like, mm-hmm. It can stop you from spending. Some people have the spending, like they're afraid they won't get an instant ROI. And sometimes there's mm-hmm. not an instant, like sometimes mm-hmm. it is you're planting seeds for the future, mm-hmm. you know? And mm-hmm. so you're just investing in your business. And if you think of it as an investment instead of like I need this instant ROI. Mm-hmm.
Right.
I think that helps
instead
too.
Of a slot machine.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. I love that. Be fearless, because I mean, I'm a very cautious person by nature, but there is something about when you're marketing, if you approach it with that attitude, it would take away the kind of apologetic
yes.
the attitude that some of us have, or we have to get over. It's like, hey, I have a new book out. I'm really sorry to bother you, but here you yeah. go. You know, yeah. that's not the way to market, right?
No. Totally.
You don't see Dr. Pepper or Coke doing that.
No,
I mean,
right.
You just don't see successful companies marketing right. that way. Yeah. And right. That you're right. I mean, that just goes to the, like the whole newsletter thing of, mm-hmm. I don't want to bother anybody. And
or I don't think they'll, what if they say no, or yeah, right, like all
right,
of that.
Right. Right.
Yeah. And it, there's also like a difference, I think, between a push and a pull. Like mm-hmm. there can be that, like, buy my book, and that yeah. also turns people off. But if there's mm-hmm. like an invitation, if you're like, okay, I know my book is awesome, so I'm going to pull out this excerpt. Mm-hmm. Right. Like then that's an invitation. And then people are like, ooh, I need more, you know, mm-hmm. and if you craft your ads as an invitation instead of a push,
yeah.
same thing.
Yeah. I love that. An invitation.
Yeah.
I
love that's great.
Because you know that that's a good book.
And
you,
yeah. It's you, like you're honoring your book mm-hmm. by like putting it on the spotlight. And then that's it becomes the invitation, you know?
Right. And you do talk about in your book about loving your books, and yes. we can talk about that in a little bit, but I love that part of the book because I have a book that I never really loved on like the others. And it really, it was kind of convicting. Yeah. I was like, oh my gosh, I've let that little book flounder.
Yes.
So what assumptions did you make at the beginning of your writing career? And looking back, did they turn out to be right or wrong?
I made this assumption. I got in by writing kinky romance, mm-hmm. like kind of niche. It was like right after 50 Shades of Grey. And so I was mm-hmm. writing like dominant submission stuff, but very like on the erotica side. And so my assumption was that I could not go mainstream with that mm-hmm. content. Mm-hmm. And I think that's sort of like, I look around now and I'm like, oh, there's lots of people who
are yeah.
making right. tons of money. Mm-hmm. But I like was like, thought that I had to make this sort of transition and, mm-hmm. you know, filter out some of that. And that's also worked for me, but I think that that was not a, I think I could have stayed the course and just believed that was good enough too, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. I agree. Yeah. I mean, I think that looking there's, around now. Yeah.
Yeah. There's room for everybody yeah. and for everything. Like, and readers want, it's like, yeah, readers want everything too. You know, yeah. there's a reader yeah. for all of it. So
yeah. yeah. That's very true. Well, we like to talk about like lessons learned and mistakes we've made. So one of our favorite questions is, have you ever made a mistake that turned out to be a good thing? Like looking back.
I have a, I got kicked out of KU story.
Oh, no.
So I had like a perma-free book. And then I was mostly in KU, like almost mm-hmm. completely, except, well, it happened twice. So like the first time I was all in KU, and the first time it happened, like I thought I was going to puke, you know, it was like, it's not like getting your account shut down, but like, they were like, you are completely kicked out of KU for a year, you mm-hmm. know, naughty, naughty. And oh, sorry. So what happened was the perma-free book, I had like put it back on sale put it back into KU, but it was still up somewhere free. Mm-hmm. Like I hadn't held it. Yeah. It was like an accident. You know, of course I didn't mean to like, and it's not like they were losing money. It was free, but whatever. Yeah. I get it. They have a policy. So they were like, you're, you know, slapped down, you know, you're out for a year. So I was like, you know, sick. And I was like, okay, I'm going to, you know, like I'm going to use, I'm an energetic person. I'm universe fix this. Mm-hmm. Like call up. I'm like super nice. Okay, no problem. They put me back in. I'm like, oh, thank God, you know. Mm-hmm. But then it happens again a year later. And at this point, I was co-writing with Vanessa Vale, and she's wide. Mm-hmm. So I had like, I don't know, three books maybe wide. And I was seeing like, wow, this is so much easier in terms of like, you don't have to do that big launch release mm-hmm. when you're mm-hmm. wide. Like KU, you know, you have to like coast mm-hmm. the algorithm, and you don't for wide. So I was like, okay, this is cool. And the money was still great. So then I get the letter that like, hey, you screwed up again. You're out. Mm-hmm. I don't know if they said permanently or for a year or whatever they said. And I was like, this time I was like, the universe said, mm-hmm. let's go wide.
Mm-hmm. You're like, thank you for your time.
Yeah.
Just the impetus you needed. So are you still wide now or did you go back in later?
I am wide now, but I am thinking, you know, because of the economy and the way things are trending, I may do a new series in KU mm-hmm. next year.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Just to try to like also to get both, keep both mm-hmm. markets.
Right. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But well, I think there's lots of authors that do that now. Yeah. Like they kind of split and they have some books wide, some books in KU, or they kind of rotate some of them in and out to kind of keep things going.
Yeah. Right. Rotating would be hard for me at this point because I went, you know, into some of those apps that have like 3-year contracts and stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I'm not sorry at all. Like I definitely,
it was a good move for you. Yeah.
Happy mistake. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, what about the opposite? Have you ever had an idea you thought this is fantastic? And then it just, there were crickets. I mean, nothing happened.
Well, one of the mistakes I made, and it was actually that book I told you I was pouring the money into. Yeah. So I released this book, you know, right when bully romance became like mm-hmm. really big, and I was, mm-hmm. and I write, shifters. And I also write dark romance. So I was like, oh, perfect. I'll do shifter bully romance. Right. Mm-hmm. So I put it out, I title it Alpha Bully. It sells like gangbusters. Mm-hmm. So I write the second one. And then I don't know what I was thinking, but I titled it. So the first one was Alpha Bully, very clearly like wolf bully. Right. Second one, I was like Alpha Knight. Well, knight does not signify bully romance.
No.
And it wouldn't sell. And then, you know, my ego was involved. Because I was like, why is this flopping? I can't have a flop. I'm like, Renee Rose can't have a flop, you know?
Yeah.
So much ego there. So I'm just like dumping like ad money and trying to make it go. And it just never went.
Yeah.
And like with perspective, I'm like, it's the title, duh. Mm-hmm. Like mm-hmm. so obvious. But and someone like recently, I was telling that story and they're like, why don't you change the title? I'm like, I don't need to change it now. Like, I think I am gonna mm-hmm. write. So I ended up like completely abandoning that series. No. I was so devastated that I was like, forget it. I'm not writing this anymore at all.
Yeah.
And then I had left characters dangling, you know, people are still mm-hmm. going like, what about them? Mm-hmm. So finally I'm like, I'm going to come back to that. And I'm not going to change that title because it'll be sandwiched between the other titles. It'll be very clearly bully romance and it'll be fine. But, that was just a colossal flop and really on a mindset level.
Yeah.
Like really the wound behind all of that is like my mindset. I couldn't get perspective enough to see what might need to be changed. Instead, it was like, oh God, I'm failing. Try to fix it with, you know, dumping money in.
Right. And then abandoning it.
Because, and then completely abandon it. Yeah. So that was a mindset fail for sure.
Yeah. Well, speaking of mindset, we do like to ask about your biggest mindset shift. I always have to be very careful about that. Saying that. Your biggest mindset shift. And so I want to talk about that, but that really leads us into your book, Right to Riches, which is all about mindset and energy work and just really breaking down blocks that you have. So tell us how you kind of got into that and where that came from.
Yeah. So I've always been into the woo woo, you know, and mm-hmm. so right from the, you know, 2012, I was going, you know, universe, I want to be a millionaire author, you know, and asking for it and trying to manifest it. And it, you know, it worked. Like I was pretty successful, and I got, you know, I got to seven figures. Sorry, I'm losing my thread, but my, but the shift really was in, so like I was attracting the money, but what was not there was really like the self-worth. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So I was actually looking for the money as proof that I was worthy.
Right. Right.
Instead of just believing that I'm a success because I wrote this amazing book and because I loved writing the book. Right. And the truth is that money follows love and joy, you know, and if you open up to receive it, it'll be there. So like, if I could have, you know, if I could do anything over, it would be like to believe I'm worthy from the beginning. Right. And then how would I be marketing myself? How would I be, you know, I wouldn't have that like grind of desperation to get to a destination, you know, that I had.
Right. Right. And that affects everything. Like that just affects everything. I had a huge epiphany while I was reading your book. Well, I had two. One is I don't really believe I can manifest things. That's a real big problem when you are, when you're trying to manifest. That, that was one of the things. And I just think it's stuff I've got to work through. I know it's stuff I have to work through. It's from my past and, you know, everything. And then secondly is that because of that outside affirmation, wanting that and everything, that in at the end of 2019, instead of putting on the gas, I pulled off the gas because I felt like I wasn't getting the affirmation. Yep. I mean, I was making money a lot of, you know, I was doing really well, but I wasn't getting that outside affirmation. And I have realized I will never get that. Like I will never, from the people I was wanting to get it from, I will never get that. And that was a huge mistake for me because that was sort of the beginning. And then, you know, of course, COVID, it was just sort of the beginning of things sort of spiraling for me a little bit, or a lot really. And so, but can you speak to that a little bit? Just,
yeah. I mean, one thing that, one of the ironies of that, like, is that you may actually get the, that, those accolades from those people, like after you no longer care, right?
It'll be right, right, yeah, exactly.
It's like, there's a block there that like, I always think of like, you know, you always hear the story of someone who can't have a child. And then as soon as they adopt, they get pregnant. And it's because like, they suddenly open up the like, oh God, I'm afraid I can't have a baby. And then like, once they're in motherhood, their body's like, oh, you want a baby?
Yeah.
You know,
whatever. Here's a baby. Yeah.
Oh, baby. Yeah. You want to be mom? Let's do mom.
Yeah.
And you were like, I was trying. So it's like that, you know, when there's like fear of it not happening, that holds it in place, you know, that sort of, those kind of blocks. And I think the thing is, a lot of people do believe that manifestation doesn't work. And that's why sometimes, like, just the tiny wins, like where you're like, I can manifest a parking spot. I can, like, for me, like, it was like, I started manifesting free stuff at my Starbucks.
Yes, I remember.
I'll be like, I'm going to pull in. Like, I just like, just do a pull. I'm like, I'm pulling in something free. I get up there and they'd be like, would you like a cookie? And I'd be like, why? Yes, I would.
Yes, I would.
Or they'd be like, you know, someone just ordered this drink. And I'm like, even if I didn't want the drink, it was like, I was proving to myself.
Yes.
Look what you just created. Yeah.
Right. 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 I think that's great. And I don't even know if it's that, I mean, I believe it works. I'm just not sure it would, I'm not sure I can personally do it. That's the block I have, you know, that because I've done all the, you know, I've done all the things, but then in the back of my mind, I'm thinking this isn't going to, you know, this isn't how this works for you. And so I've really had to think about that and work through some things. I've had some other things going on, but
yes,
yeah.
Definitely.
Yeah. So that's on there.
Right.
But, totally. Yeah.
Well, can you tell us, since you were talking a little bit about blocks, what are like the most common blocks you see that writers have to work through? I think we've talked about like not believing that we can make things happen, but what else do you see?
I mean, the like not worthy, that what it kind of seems like it boils down, people have like really similar core wounds that affect them. And it's all, and also money wounds, but like the not feeling worthy, like not fitting in. So there's that, anything that has to do with like being rejected by others, being abandoned by others. Sometimes you don't want to do better than your, you know, your friend in the business.
Right.
So you pace with them success-wise. Because if you get too far ahead, they're going to stab you in the back, or, you know, or they're, you won't be friends
anymore.
They won't
like
you'll hurt their feelings. Like you don't want to leave them behind.
Right.
So like in like that fitting in thing can be mm-hmm. a stopping place. Sometimes it's you're pacing with a husband, like a spouse, mm-hmm. like, oh, I don't want to make more than him. That mm-hmm. would emasculate him. Mm-hmm. Stuff like that. Sometimes people are even still under like a parent where they're like their parent likes to take care of them and they don't want to surpass that. And then there's the like, it doesn't work for me kind of comes up a lot, like this, yes, for other people, but not for me. Like mm-hmm. there's sort of some belief in there that like, it doesn't apply to you or it's not, right. you know, just that. And then I think I can't, or I don't know how,
mm-hmm.
just that sort of stuck of like, mm-hmm. instead of like feeling powerful, there's like a powerless feeling.
Yeah.
You know, yeah. instead of being like, oh, I am a powerful creator and I can figure out anything I don't know. It's that mm-hmm. like, oh, I don't mm-hmm. know how to do this. Like I'm like, mm-hmm. you get kind of that sort of impotent
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
energy that kind of stops you.
Yeah. Yeah. I know that's a block, but what are some of the mistakes you see authors making when it comes to not just manifesting, but like trying to move forward in their career? I mean, I can think just like as a whole, I think as an industry, we all have a cloud of negativity hanging over us.
Oh yeah.
But what else do you see?
I mean, one thing I say, like I usually like to say is there are no mistakes because mm-hmm. like every choice you make moves you, mm-hmm. you know, helps you get clearer and moves you forward. However, like there are distractors, I think. Mm-hmm. And I think the drama, when mm-hmm. people start doing like drama and trauma with the you know, this yeah. author said that, yeah. you know, like yeah. that sort of thing.
Yeah.
That's a distractor.
Mm-hmm.
That keeps you. And then competition, I think mm-hmm. can be it'll keep you yeah. from creating if you're competing, yeah. like looking at everyone else all the time instead of like doing your own thing.
Yeah. Yeah.
And other distractors.
I can think like Amazon, you know,
yeah, blaming.
Amazon's like against us all, yes. you know, all
the sky is falling stuff like the yes, blaming yes, others for, yeah, it's again, yeah. that's like that impotency, right? Mm-hmm, like you're, mm-hmm. you don't think you're in power. You're like, have to sit back and take it, whatever mm-hmm, happens mm-hmm. instead of being like, no, I'm like the captain of the ship.
Yes.
Even if yeah. it's just energetic, like I may not be running Amazon, but I can just like, I got my account back when I wanted to. And then when mm-hmm. I didn't, I was like, whatever, you know?
Yeah. Yeah.
And I have had my entire account shut down 3 times.
Oh my gosh.
So, and we get it back. Like every time it yeah. gets, we get it back faster. So.
Yes. That's awesome.
Yeah.
That's encouraging for people.
Yeah. Well,
you talk in the book about mistakes and like, you were asked to go to this author signing and, you were in Europe and you were nervous about it. But your gut was telling you to go. And so you went and a lot of things happened along the way that weren't great. I mean, did your luggage got lost or something?
My luggage got lost. And then yes. like, they, you know, a lot of things they said, they were like, oh, we'll have someone waiting for you.
Oh yeah.
Nobody was there. and then they were supposed to cover my plane ticket and I doubt I'll ever see that money. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. But they did cover the hotel. And then mm-hmm. I did have a translator when I got there, which was great. But yeah, what I got, like I was really on the fence. And so I could see, like, I was feeling both those energies, right? Mm-hmm. I was feeling that chaos that things mm-hmm. weren't going to be as promised.
Mm-hmm.
And then, but I kept hearing like, just go and receive.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And so then it was like magical. Like I went through Amsterdam.
Mm-hmm.
I was on the way to Toulouse and a friend of mine was on the same flight.
Crazy.
I know. And then that we hadn't planned that. I had yeah. sent my itinerary because I was going through Amsterdam. I sent it to her just in case,
mm-hmm.
but she had, I don't know if she'd looked at it until that morning when it turns out they had a family emergency and her husband couldn't go. So mm-hmm. then she was suddenly like, am I going to go alone? Mm-hmm. Then she sees, oh, look, Renee's on the same flight. I'm not right. alone.
Right. Right?
So then
right.
the two of us are not alone. We don't speak French, but at least we're together.
Yes.
When we get there and there's nobody there right. and my luggage is lost. Like I've got a buddy while my, you know, dealing with lost luggage. And then like the, you know, the readers were just amazing. Like, so, mm-hmm. and yet like it was a super chaotic conference, things mm-hmm. as promised, not showing up, including for the, like the readers were angry about things, but they were standing in lines. They were, mm-hmm. they were so nice. And I felt so received and it was just a beautiful experience. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. But it was the kind of thing, like, had I shut down and gone into that victim mode,
right,
it would have
powerless
sucked.
Yeah,
yeah. Mm-hmm. If I was like, oh my god, my mm-hmm. flight's not taken care of, and now this, like, nobody was here, you know, I could have just like done the blamey thing the whole time, mm-hmm. and had a miserable time, mm-hmm. but I'd gotten the message to receive, and it turned into magic. Mm-hmm. And now that author, we're gonna write together.
That's awesome.
So that's like, just, it was, you know, just yeah. totally so fun.
Yeah. Yeah. And it is just perspective. It is like how you look at things, trusting yourself. I mean, you made the decision and trusting that it was going to work out. And so I love that story. When I was reading, I actually was listening to it and went back and listened again to that story after I'd listened to it right then, because I just thought, I am not like that. I mean, you know, I can see me sitting there just grinding my teeth instead of just opening up and receiving what you've already feel like you were going to get anyway. So I love that.
Yeah, and I think that could shift any situation, you know, like any situation if you just decided to, it's like that the world is a benevolent place versus a place of lack and strife.
Right.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, let's talk a little bit about, like, I think as authors, a lot of, we're in our heads a lot, or I know I am. And let's talk about like negative self-talk or how we talk to ourselves, because that can make a huge difference too, right? I mean, a lot of times we don't realize we're even doing it.
Seriously, there was this point last year where I realized that like all I said to myself all day were like bullying thoughts. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. It was like, oh, you better start right. Because I'm kind of a taskmaster. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. You know, so it's like, you better get back in your chair. You better write more words. You better, you know, it's like I couldn't stop managing myself, and I was a really mean manager.
Were you a mean boss?
I was a terrible boss. I hated working for myself. And so then, like, just trying to have like, and it's still a process, but just a lot more grace and kindness for myself.
Yeah.
And for my body, like, sometimes I bully my body, like, you know, why aren't you as strong as you were when you were 25? You know, during COVID, I ripped my rotator cuff because I was like, you know, I used to be able to do 12 push-ups, and I thought I still should be able to. And like, after the third, I tore my shoulder.
Oh my gosh.
Know, because I was bullying, you know, I wasn't listening. Yeah. I was bullying myself.
Mm-hmm. Well, what are some things we can do? Like, if we can't, I suppose the first thing would be like to realize we're doing it.
Catch yourself and doing
then,
it. Yeah.
Like, how do we change that or get out of that habit?
Yeah. I mean, I think a lot of times if you just, you can flip it on its head and be like, you know, so if I'm going, you haven't gotten hardly any words in today, you know, I can be like, okay, like, what did I get done? Like, actually, I had a really busy morning. I had people calling me all day, and it's understandable. I didn't get any words in. And so you're doing great considering what you've already done today, you know, like,
Right. I love that. Yeah. You do talk a lot about flipping things around or flipping them on their head and stuff. I love that. What about money wounds? Like, what are some money wounds that we have that we don't even know we have?
Yeah, there's so many that are pervasive. But one of them is like the whole rich people are evil thing.
Yes.
So even though we want money, if we believe rich people suck, we're going to be like subconsciously blocking it.
Yeah.
From showing up. Mm-hmm. And if you're like, even like I was unwilling to like step into like boss shoes. So then I couldn't hire a PA because I didn't want to be a boss, you know, like I wasn't, that's place of power to me. That was like someone who was unkind, like boss just meant, I don't know, something I did, an energy I wasn't willing to be for a while.
Yeah.
Or landlord. It was hard for me to be a landlord at first and, things like that. So just noticing like what you reject. It's funny to me, like now that I have written the book, like how often I hear people say really negative things about people with money.
Yeah.
And you know, like all, like it's all, it's everywhere all the time.
It's almost like it's a passive aggressive thing. I guess like you don't really, you want it, but then you don't, but then, you know, it's very weird. Our attitude.
Totally. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Totally.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I think I'm going to be better. I was like thinking about that because a lot of times, you know, now that I've been noticing it, but I haven't said anything, but I was like, I might as well just say something like, hey, do you want to be abundant? Because if so, you know, maybe look at that. Like you're blocking yourself, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. Because abundance is, I mean, there is that, well, what you said earlier, abundance follows love. And if you're feeling really negative towards somebody or something like that, it's going to be really hard.
Yeah. You're rejecting money on some level.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
And that how becomes a block.
I mean, other than just noticing it, are there some ways we can turn it around? Or,
well, one of the things, one of the exercises I've tried is saying, just, are you able to say I love money out loud without kind of going, because it feels kind of icky.
So
at
basic,
first.
But yeah,
it is. But right. Until you can say it, until you can say it with joy and not like cringing, like I love money, then money won't be attracted to you. You got, it's again, like it, you're right. It follows love. And so can you love money? Can you love on money? Can you be grateful to money? Can you, cause that'll be an invitation instead of pushing away.
Yeah. That's so good. I bet a lot of our listeners are going, oh, sure, I can. Yeah.
Seriously. Yeah. You're like, I love money.
Exactly. Well, speaking of love, talk about loving your books. Like, what does that look like? The third book in my series was super hard to, in my bride series was super hard to write, just for multiple reasons. And it's not exactly like the other books, but I've reread it recently and I was like, that is a dang good book. Like awesome. It is a really good book. It's just different. And some of the reviews reflected that. And, but that's the book that I realized I don't really love on that book hardly at all. I hardly ever run ads on it. I hardly ever do anything to promote it. So,
yes. Well, that. My advice is since you did just reread it and realize how great it is, go ahead and apply for a book bub right now on it.
Oh, okay.
Because when you apply with that energy, it does something.
Okay. Yeah.
So anytime I'm vibing high on a certain book or something, I'll be like, oh, use this love because the love becomes the fuel behind it. Or it gives it wings, right? So then you apply for your book bub or you write the ad copy for it.
Right. Yeah.
Because you're launching it into the world with your love and that will attract. It'll attract readers. It'll attract positivity. Yeah.
I love that. I mean, I had never thought about that before. I had never thought about that. And I'm pretty woo-woo. I'm not on the same level as you, but I'm so few are. But I am. No, I'm kidding.
It's true.
I am not. I just had never really even considered that the way I think about my books affects them.
Yeah. You know? And I have some really specific stories and then people shared them with me that ended up as case studies in the book of where people just loving on their books, like Matt, like they hit the USA Today list. One of my favorite stories is Lee James. She was breaking her books up into chapters to put on to Radish. She was putting it into Radish and Kiss. And so in the process, like you, she reread it and was like, this is such a good book. You know, she's like, if it had been Wide instead of in KU when it launched, I bet it would have hit the list. And meanwhile, it's been her dream to hit the list. And then unbeknownst to her, like Kiss starts advertising that book. It hits the list 2 weeks in a row.
Oh my gosh.
Wow.
She never could have manufactured that. Right. Like it was just asking the universe to hit the list and loving on her book.
Right.
And it came, you know,
just so awesome.
I know. I love that story.
I love that story. That's so great.
Yeah.
Cause I mean, I can look back on my career. I mean, Sara into, you know, where we have like unconsciously, I mean, you know, it wasn't something we were like, okay, I'm going to love on my book. But I mean, we've confidence or just because you did love a book, it did so well. I think that's probably why my first book did so well, because I love that book. I mean, because it was the first one and it was just, I used every joke I had.
Your excitement is infectious, it draws people to it. Yeah.
Yeah. And I think first also you're like wide open. So you don't have all these expectations in place.
Right.
Right. Exactly. So your energy is like, what's possible for this book? The second ones were, then we're like, okay, well that's supposed to happen again. And then when it doesn't, we're like, well, you know, what happened?
Right.
But a lot of first initial success is because we're wide open and we're loving and we're excited. And
I love that. And when Sara hit the list by herself, I mean, she did, you just really had a lot of confidence. I mean, and then she called me after she had hit it. She's like, you're the only one that's going to know, be happy for
truly
me about
understand.
This. Yeah, really understand. And, But I mean, you know, that's hard to do, to hit a list by yourself and
yes,
without, yeah, you know, being an anthology or it being this big thing. And
yeah, I it was very cool. Yeah. Yeah.
Very
cool.
Really, yes,
cool. Yeah. Yes. And I think it's very true about like when you do something first, you don't really know. And so you're kind of like, cause I just did a Kickstarter and it did really well. And I realized I'm already like in a little back corner of my mind, I'm already thinking like, if I do another one, will it do as well? So I'm already like nervous for
hedging.
That.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so like from talking today, I'm like, I just need to let that go and just go into it the same way, be just as excited and just as open and let my readers respond. Mm-hmm. And I had another author say, why are you so stressed? Your readers are there for you. They're there for the Kickstarter. And I was like, yeah, you're right. Yes. So it's like the stories we tell ourselves really impact how we behave.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Totally.
Yeah. So you said you'd always been kind of like, how did you move into the space of, you know?
Yeah. So very early on, abundance. I was sort of indoctrinated into the like, you know, thoughts, our thoughts create our reality. Like in my early 20s, like maybe like right out of college. And so I already had that, that belief. And then I'm a dancer. I was a body worker. So I'm like really interested in like physical healing, but then that sort of became like energy work on the body. And then the two sort of became together, like energy work on your life. I didn't know it was going to go that way, but that's kind of how it's gone. So it's been this sort of natural progression of like this book, Right to Riches, felt like the culmination of like everything, you know, from my energy work and healing into my writing into, you know, all of that together.
Yeah. I love that. And are there some books you would, besides yours, because it's super good, but other books that you would recommend for people to read on this subject?
Yeah, there's some really great ones. I love Get Rich Lucky Bitch and You Are a Badass with Money. And then also The Universe Has Your Back.
Yes.
Yeah. I like Feel Free to Prosper.
Oh, I haven't heard that one.
Yeah. It's she's got some tools like that where you sort of like follow her recipe and she guarantees you that you'll, this might be the good, like to show that it works for you, because she guarantees within 3 weeks you're going to see something show up. Yeah.
That's cool. It's I'll go cool. get it right now.
Okay, cool.
I'm going to get off and go get it. Yeah.
And then like Mike Dooley has some like Playing the Matrix, some good. And his one of his big messages is like, you don't have to worry about the how. You make your ask.
Yes.
And you don't worry about the how. Because we get so controlling, and then that actually limits possibilities.
Right. That is one thing that came out of the book for me too. I remember, because I always want to like, how is this going to work?
Yeah. I need the map. Like, where's the map?
Yes. And sometimes we, just like the woman you were just talking about, hitting that list.
Yeah. She could never have manufactured.
No. We don't have to worry about the how. We just have to ask and put ourselves in a position of receiving. And yeah.
Yes, exactly.
I think that's so great. Well, what about podcasts? Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah. Go ahead, Sara.
No, I was going to say, since we're talking about books, give the name of your book again. It's Write, WRITE, right?
Yes, exactly.
Anybody Googling right now?
With a W, yes.
Okay, there we go.
Super good. And then any podcasts that you listen to on any of this? Or because we're big podcast people.
That's a good question. I feel like there was one I used to really love. I'm drawing a total blank.
I'll have to
email you if I think of.
Yeah. We'll put it in the show notes and stuff. Yeah.
Okay. Cool.
Yeah. Well, this has been great.
Thank you so much.
Do you have any other questions? Because I just have picked your brain all to pieces today.
Well, I would just say, like, I guess like our question that we normally end on would be the main one I would want to ask. Do you have anything else, Jami, or not?
Nope.
All right. Well, what's the best thing you've done to set yourself up for success?
Loved myself.
Preach. I loved.
And that's a hard journey.
It is. It's so hard. It's just so hard, but I think that's so great. And you can really see that progression in your book. I mean, you can just really see that. And I I'm just so happy. I'm happy you've come to the place you are, because you are a seven-figure author, and you have been for a little while, correct?
This is my third year.
Yes. Yep. And so you have really practiced what you preach and put things down, and I'm just so happy for all your success. So tell people where they can find out about you and the books and everything.
Yes. So my website, write, WRITE, mm-hmm. number 2, RICHES.com.
Okay. That's the website.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And then I have a Facebook group called mm-hmm. Author Abundance Central.
Correct.
And anyone can jump in there, and I would love to see you. And then in there, you'll see there's posts, but you can sign up to get author affirmations sent to your mm-hmm. inbox. Mm-hmm. And I actually have some merch, like where you can drink mm-hmm. out of a millionaire author mug and
yeah,
stuff like fun. That. So, yeah.
Yes. And you have courses on your website, correct?
Yes. So I'm running right now an 8-week course. And then there's also a monthly membership mm-hmm. For authors so once a month we get together in Zoom and just chat through what the energies are at the moment and what we can do to clear and mm-hmm. attract and all of that. It's very, mm-hmm. Very nourishing.
Yeah. Yeah. Everybody that's in it really talks positively about it. So
yeah, that is great. That is wonderful. Yeah. Well, we'll have all those links in the show notes.
Yes.
And they'll be at wishidknownthenpodcast.com. So thank you so much for being here and sharing about your book and your journey. It's been very inspiring.
Yeah. Yeah, it has been.
Thank you so much for having me.
All right.
Mm. Yeah. And thanks to Alexa Larberg for editing and producing the podcast, and to Adria Wiggins for doing the admin. And we'll see everybody next week. Bye.
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 Thanks for listening to the Wish I'd Known Then podcast. We hope this episode inspired you, empowered you, and made you laugh a little bit too. If you loved it, tell your friends about it. And if you feel so inclined, leave us a review. We look forward to being with you again next week.